So welcome back again to the electric circuit lectures. We were in chapter 8. We were discussing the AC circuits and we started our discussion with sinusoidal and phasors. So we will carry forward this from where we have left in lecture 8A. This is the lecture 8B that we are going to discuss today. So let us focus on sinusoidal now into much deep. So you have seen that in sinusoidal quantity can be represented in the form of a phasor. So when we talk in terms of a phasor, the frequency remains constant and it is only for the sinusoidal quantity. So if we have the complex plane on the y-axis, that is the imaginary axis, and on the x-axis, that is the real axis. So the phasor diagram for the voltage and the current. Now, what is the voltage? So in phasor, we write in capital V, the voltage is equal to the magnitude is represented with Vm, which is the maximum magnitude, and the angle is represented with phi. Now, if the quantity current is lagging or leading with respect to the voltage, then we will be having different phasor notation. So that depends how the voltage and current angle are differing from each other. So let us see. So here in this phasor diagram, we have the voltage here and we have the current here. We know that angle is always measured in anti-clockwise direction. So the voltage phasor, the length of this phasor from starting from here, that is the zero, and till here the length, whatever the length is there, that length is basically the magnitude of the quantity that we are measuring, whether it is a voltage or the current. So the total length of the phasor represent the magnitude, and the angle with respect to the real axis in the anti-clockwise direction will be used to measure the angle. And the difference of the angle between the voltage and the current will decide whether it is a lagging quantity or whether it is a leading quantity. So here we have a positive angle for the voltage. So we are moving in the anti-clockwise direction in the positive way. And here we have the negative minus theta. So we have moved in the negative direction of the angle minus theta. So the voltage in the anti-clockwise direction is the leading direction, and the current, you can see that it is in the clockwise direction, so that represents a lagging direction. Now there will be representation in the form of a time domain and phasor domain. So in phasor domain, the representation is much simpler compared to the time domain. So let us see how to represent it. If you have the voltage, which is represented with Vm cos omega t plus theta or phi, here the angle is, the constant quantity here is basically the frequency. So the frequency will remain constant. So we have to keep the frequency constant, then only we can represent it in terms of the phasor. So these time domain representation can be represented in the form of a phasor, where you see that this is independent of the frequency omega, because we consider that the frequency omega is constant. So here we have the magnitude Vm, which is coming directly from the time domain representation, and the angle phi, which is coming in the form of an angle. So both omega, that is the frequency, and the time t is not there in the phasor representation. Now, if we have here the sine and this one cos, you can convert that into one single quantity, either the sine or the cosine. So here we have represented in the form of a cosine. So the phi angle is converted to phi minus 90 degree to make it to be a cosine angle. Here, the current Im cos omega t plus theta will be represented as Im angle theta, and the other angle where you have the sine representation, you can represent as theta minus 90 degree. So in the previous lecture also this we have discussed that when you need to compare the phase angle, you have to convert that into one trigonometric form, either the sine or the cosine. So we can take here the cosine angle as the reference for the measurement purpose. Now what is the difference between the time domain and the frequency domain? Usually the time domain is represented with a small letter, that is small v, with an angle, with a representation of a function as the time t, and the capital V represent the phasor representation. So whenever you are having some capital sign, you understand that that is a phasor. So if we differentiate the time domain and the frequency domain, we see that time domain is basically used to represent the instantaneous quantity or the time domain quantity. For example, if you have the voltage with respect to time t, then this is a sinusoidal quantity. This sinusoidal quantity at any instant is basically a function of time. So at any instant, if you put it, it is a function of time. Whereas a phasor is independent of time as well as independent of frequency. Both time and frequency are not there because we consider that frequency is constant. So in the frequency or phasor domain, we will have the capital V. This is a time dependent quantity. This is not, time is independent here. This is a real, no complex term will be associated. So this is also very important. Whenever you have the time dependent quantity, the terms of the voltage and the current is basically the real quantity. You will have only real number. Whereas voltage and current for the phasor representation generally are complex. Why complex? You have seen in the previous derivation, we have the exponential term in the derivation. So this exponential term is creating this complex number. Now, in phasor representation, the frequency or time factor e to the power j omega t is suppressed because omega is constant. So we are not including this term in the phasor representation because we treat the frequency to be constant. However, the response surely depends upon omega. So when you change the frequency, the response will change. So phasor domain is known as the frequency domain. So the other name of phasor domain is basically frequency domain. That is the reason when we say how many domains are there for the representation, we have two domains. One is time domain and another is frequency domain. So in time domain, we represent as voltage with respect to time t, current with respect to time t. So here we have small letter, small caps, and here you have the capital V and capital I to represent in the form of a phasor, that is frequency. Now, if you have the voltage in the time domain represented in the form Vm cos omega t plus phi, so this is the instantaneous representation, means for different time instant t1, t2 and t3 and so on, you will be getting different voltage v1, v2, v3 and so on. So this is the instantaneous representation. Frequency remains constant, omega, and the phi is the angle which is with respect to the real axis in the anti-clockwise direction. So always we measure the angle in the anti-clockwise direction to represent the value of phi. Now the length of this phasor, that is the voltage Vm, and this one is phi. So that representation in the frequency domain or in the phasor domain is given as V is equal to Vm angle phi. So we are taking only the angle and the length of the vector. Now if we differentiate this voltage with respect to time t, then we will be getting here in this format where Re stands for real quantity. So due to the cosine presentation or the exponential, we will be having the complex quantity. Now we can represent dv by dt in the form of a real quantity. Now let us convert the time domain into phasor domain. When we have dv by dt, then we can convert that into j omega v, where j is basically the iota term, that is under root of minus 1, and omega is the frequency and capital V is basically the phasor. So dV by dt can be represented in this format. The integral of the voltage can be represented in the form of V by j omega. Now, by now, you must have understood that what is the advantage of converting the time domain to frequency domain is basically these differential and integral term, that is the integro-differential equation that is appearing in the inductor and the capacitor voltage and the current equation will disappear and you will be getting algebraic equation. So the advantage of phasor, that is in frequency domain, is removal of time differentiation and integration. So dV by dt, an integral of the voltage which we used to get it in transient analysis due to the presence of inductor and capacitor, will be converted to the frequency domain, and then we will be getting the algebraic equation. Also, when we are dealing with different frequency, suppose we are dealing with omega 1, omega 2 and so on, then we can add those sinusoids, that is, we can sum the sinusoids of the same frequency, right? So all omega 1 term will be added together, all omega 2 term will be added together. In this way, we can have much easier representation and the solution. Let us solve one problem to understand how to do that. So one problem is to transform the sinusoids to phasor. So we have a current time domain quantity, that is the instantaneous quantity, and we have a voltage quantity. You see here we have represented the current and voltage in small caps. Now, in order to convert this quantity which is in time domain to frequency domain or the phasor, we have to first observe that what is the omega term here. So you know the general representation is xm, and then you have cos of omega t plus phi. This is the general representation. Xm means the voltage or the current, so you will be having Vm or Im, cos omega t plus phi, omega is constant. Now let us see the current equation first. Current is given by 6 cos 50 t minus 40 degree. So you can observe that here the angle is given in degrees, which is has to be converted into radian when you have to do some calculation. However, in representation purpose, this is given in degree. But do not calculate this in degree, otherwise you will be committing a mistake. The reason is that 50 t unit is in radian. How? We have omega t, I'll just explain how it is. So omega unit is radian per second multiplied with second. So you have a radian unit here. So here also radian has to be there, but this is a general representation in the form of a degree. This is very important point to note here. Generally students commit mistake here, they take in degrees. So the current here is 6 cos 50 t minus 40 degree. So you have to represent that into phasor form. So here we have the cosine term and the maximum magnitude is 6, which we have kept out here as 6. Here we have the angle as 40 degree with a negative sign. So we have kept here minus 40 degree and capital I represent the phasor representation of the current. Now we'll take the voltage. So in the voltage we have sine representation. You can see we have a sine representation. So we need to convert the sine quantity into cosine. Moreover, the magnitude has to be always positive. So here we have a negative sign here, so that we need to convert into positive. So minus 4 sine 30 t plus 50 degree has to be converted in the form of a cosine angle, cos. So when we convert that into cos, we are getting 4 cos 30 t plus 140 degree. So when we represent that into phasor format, so here we have the maximum magnitude 4 and the angle here is 140 degree. So angle here is 140 degree and the omega value is 30. So omega is 30. Here omega is 50. Okay. Now these two are independent problem. These are not dependent problem. If the voltage and current both are coming out from the same circuit or the same measurement quantity, then our frequency has to be constant. It means here either it should be 30 dB or here it should be 50 dB. Then only the two quantities has to be equal and you can say that both are of the same circuit. This is independent problem where two quantities were given and we have to convert that into phasor. This is not a part of a circuit problem. Now we will take circuit elements. These circuit elements are sometimes said to be modeling elements, which are basically the parameters resistor, inductor and capacitor, the RLC quantity. So can we represent these RLC quantities into phasor format? So we have to represent the RLC, resistor, inductor and capacitor in phasor format, and then we see how to do the calculation. Let us start with a resistor. So when we have a resistor here R, the voltage applied in the time domain is represented with small v and the current which is flowing in the network is small I. In accordance with Ohm's law, we have V is equal to I into R. Now let us see whether we convert, how we can convert this time domain into frequency domain. So we have the current in the time domain representation as Im cos of omega t plus phi, where Im is the maximum magnitude and omega is the frequency and phi is basically the angle with which the current is being represented. So if I convert this into phasor format on the real axis and imaginary axis, the length of the vector will be V and the current is I. So we have started from current and then we will reach to voltage. So let us see the current. Current with respect to the angle is phi. So we have represented I as maximum magnitude into phi. Now let us apply the Ohm's law here. V is equal to I into R. This is coming from the Ohm's law. And then we put the equation of the current here. So we have R into Im cos omega t plus phi. Can we represent this voltage from time domain to phasor representation? So we are having a maximum magnitude of R into Im. So here we will be having Vm is equal to R into Im and the angle is basically phi. What we are observing here is that the angle of the current is phi and the angle of the voltage is phi. It means that both voltage and current are in same phase, that is phi. So we have the current and voltage on the same line. Okay, voltage and current on the same line. However, there is a difference in their magnitude. What is the difference in their magnitude? The magnitude of the current is basically Im. So Im is the magnitude of the current. And here the magnitude is R into Im. So we can say R into Im is more than the value of Im. So our voltage, if this is the current, the voltage will be a little bit bigger than the current, because the length of the vector R into Im is more compared to Im. However, both will be in the same line because it is in phase with each other. So we can write in phasor representation as the voltage is basically current multiplied with resistance, and both in the phasor representation. So small v will become capital V here in phasor representation, small I will become capital I, and resistance will remain same. So this resistance is same and the Ohm's law is coming as V is equal to I into R. So the main point to be remembered here is that the voltage and current are in phase with each other. Both voltage and current are in phase with each other because we have the same phase angle phi for the voltage and current. The angle difference between voltage and current, if you take the angle difference between voltage and current, that is 0 degree. So we do not have any angle difference between voltage and current, and hence we can say that they are in phase with each other. Let us move to the inductor now. So we have an inductor which is represented with a voltage small v drawing a current I, and the voltage we know that V is equal to L di by dt. This we have already studied. LdI/dt. Now let us start deriving it to understand. So the voltage is LdI/dt, where the current I equation can be written as Im. We have the cos term, cos of omega t plus phi. This is the current equation. Here we have the di/dt term, we have the differentiation term. So we have to differentiate the current with respect to time. So we'll get the voltage equation. Now here if you observe that we have the sine representation, so we have to convert that into cosine to get the voltage in the better format, in the form of cosine angle. So these voltage, whatever we have got it, we convert that into exponential, means converting the trigonometric form into the exponential form, and then we convert that into the angle and the magnitude form, that is the polar coordinate. So here we have the magnitude as omega L into Im, whereas the angle is phi plus 90 degree. So what is the angle of the current? The, if we convert that into phasor representation, current will be equal to Im, angle phi. So what is the angle we are getting for the voltage? Voltage is equal to Vm. Let us not look into the voltage magnitude now. The angle is phi plus 90 degree. So what we see here, the angle is phi, here the angle is phi plus 90 degree for the voltage. So the magnitude of the voltage phasor we can represent, or the voltage phasor we can represent in the form of omega L into I. So here you have omega into L, and Im angle phi we can represent it as capital I, with J term is coming because the J term is coming from 90 degree. This 90 degree we have there. So we have the J term. So the voltage is basically J into omega into L into current. Now understand here, this J into omega, omega L, we can represent that into XL, as XL. XL is the inductive reactance of the network. So we can write XL is equal to omega into L, where omega is the frequency in radian per second, and this is the inductor L. And the current is multiplied with the XL value, that is the inductive reactance, to get the voltage. So the, if we say what is the unit, here you have the unit of volt for the voltage. So if we observe the angle of the current and the voltage, we can say that voltage and current are 90 degree out of phase, specifically saying the current lags voltage by 90 degree. So whenever we talk about the inductor, the current is lagging the voltage by 90 degree. Let us represent that in the form of a phasor. So we have a real axis and imaginary axis. We have the voltage and the current. So let us start with the current here. Current is with an angle of phi. So we have represented that in the form of a phi. Now voltage here is, we can say that leading the current, because current lags voltage. So voltage will lead the current by 90 degrees. So there will be an angle difference of 90 degree between the current and the voltage for the inductor. Now here, one important point is that this is the pure inductor, lossless inductor. There is no resistive part, only inductor is there. We do not have any resistor element. Usually, inductor will not be a pure quantity. You will be having an RL combination, that is the resistor with an inductor in series. But here we are talking only for the inductor. So the angle between voltage and current for a pure inductor or ideal inductor is 90 degree, where current lags voltage by 90 degree. So the voltage is represented in the phasor format as capital V. The current is represented in the phasor format as capital I, and the inductor remain constant, and the voltage is represented in the form of J omega L into I. So in better format, we can write that voltage is equal to XL, that is the inductive reactance, multiplied with current, XL into I. In Ohm's law, we have written voltage is equal to resistance into current. This is when we have a resistive circuit. I will give a suffix R here. When the voltage of an inductor, we are writing here is XL into I. So the resistor has become XL now for the inductor, where XL is basically omega L. Now J term will come because you have a 90 degree difference between the voltage and the current. Same thing let us do for the capacitor here. So in the capacitor, you know that current flowing through a capacitor is equal to C dV by dt, right? So here we have the differential term C dV by dt, and when we differentiate in the same manner what we have done for the inductor and then we substitute, we get the voltage is equal to current divided by J omega C. So now let us write the equation again for the resistor that we have got. So in the resistor we have got R multiplied with current, in the inductor we have got XL multiplied with current. So in the capacitor we should have XC multiplied with current. So this is known as capacitive reactance, this is known as inductive reactance. So what is XC here? So XC will be equal to 1 by omega C, and there will be a J term because we see that voltage and current are again 90 degree out of phase, similar to the inductor, and specifically saying that the current leads voltage by 90 degree. If we see the inductor was current lags voltage by 90 degree. This is inductor and this is capacitor. So in the capacitor, the current will be leading the voltage by 90 degree. So we have started with the reference quantity as voltage here. In the previous derivation or the previous phasor, we have represented the current. Here we have the voltage, that is with the angle phi, and the current is leading the voltage by 90 degree here. So current is leading the voltage by 90 degree. Anti-clockwise direction is the positive direction. So the main point to remember in this type of network is the summary of the relationship between the voltage and the current quantity in the time domain and in the frequency domain. In the time domain, we will be having dV by dt term or integral of voltage dt term. Integral and differential term will be there in the time domain, which will be represented in the form of J into omega term in the frequency domain. So we know from Ohm's law, the voltage will be equal to I into R. This will be converted into capital V is equal to capital R multiplied with I. Resistor remains constant. There is no change in the resistor here. Only the voltage and the current from time dependent to frequency dependent, it has changed. The voltage in the inductor is L di by dt, which has been converted to capital V is equal to J omega Li. In better format, we can write voltage of the inductor is equal to XL, that is the inductive reactance multiplied with the current. XL is equal to J omega L. The voltage of the capacitor is 1 by C integral I dt, that is in time domain. In the frequency domain, we can write V is equal to I by J omega C. So voltage of the capacitor is equal to XC multiplied with current, where XC, that is the capacitive reactance, is equal to 1 by J omega C. So here we see that the integral and differential term vanish and we have only the algebraic term. So whenever we are doing the transient analysis or steady state analysis, we can do the computation in a much simpler format. Next topic will take impedance and admittance of a network. Now if we are dealing with the ratio quantity, ratio of what? Voltage by current. Let us see what is the ratio of voltage by current for the resistor, inductor and capacitor. So the ratio of voltage by current. So ratio of voltage by current for a pure inductor is R, for a pure resistor is R, pure inductor is J omega L, and pure capacitor is 1 by J omega C. When I say pure, it means it is an ideal. There is no lossless component. There is the resistive component here is not there. The resistive component here is not there. It is only a pure inductor and a pure capacitor. This is the ratio of the voltage by current. Now, Ohm's law we have studied in the time domain. Let us study the Ohm's law in the frequency domain or the phasor format. So the ratio of voltage by current is basically given by a term which is known as impedance Z. Because we have to deal with resistor, inductor and capacitor together. Resistor, inductor and capacitor. If you remembered, in the DC circuit, we were having only the resistor. Inductor and capacitor were not there. In the AC circuit, we will be having resistor, inductor and capacitor. So we can't simply rely on the resistor. So there is a new term coming, which is known as the impedance. Impedance means the ratio of voltage by current. So whenever we talk about the ratio of voltage by current, we always say that this is a resistance. This is only for the DC quantity, because the inductive effect and capacitive effect was not there. Now, due to the presence of inductor and capacitor, which is coming from the magnetic field and electric field, we will be having a new term, that is impedance, which is the ratio of voltage by current. So unit is in ohms, okay, and this is a frequency dependent quantity. Okay, this is not a time dependent quantity, this is a frequency dependent quantity. So if we talk about the unit here, the resistor unit is in ohms, j omega l unit is in ohms, and 1 by j omega c unit is in ohms. Remember, the unit of inductor is in Henry, millihenry or microhenry. Capacitor unit is in farad, microfarad. But when we deal with the impedance Z, we have to convert this Henry to ohms. We have to convert this farad to ohms. So that can be done by multiplying with J omega into L, 1 by J omega into C. So we have to convert the Henry to omega and we have to convert the farad to omega, that is. So impedance is basically the ratio of voltage by current. This is a frequency dependent quantity, and the Ohm's law in phasor form can be represented as the voltage is equal to impedance multiplied with current. If you remember the Ohm's law in time domain, small v is equal to current multiplied with resistance, small current multiplied with resistance. In phasor domain, capital V is equal to capital I. Now resistance is not only present, so we will have Z. Z is the impedance. Now let us define what is the impedance. Impedance Z of a circuit is the ratio of the phasor voltage to phasor current, and it is measured in ohms. This is the definition of impedance. So impedance is basically the ratio of voltage by current. Both are in phasor quantity and the unit is in ohms. Otherwise, we can say that impedance is the opposition to the current that the circuit exhibits to the flow of sinusoidal current. Okay, so whenever you have a sinusoidal current, the net opposition that the circuit exhibits, that is known as the impedance. In DC, you have the constant magnitude of the current. This is the constant magnitude. But when we talk about the AC quantity, we have the sinusoidal varying quantity. So the net opposition to the flow of current is basically the impedance. Now, one important point here to be note here is that although the impedance is the ratio of two phasor voltage by current, it is not a phasor. Impedance is not a phasor because it is does not correspond to a sinusoidal varying quantity. Voltage and current are only phasors. But when we take the ratio of voltage by current, that is not a phasor because it is not a sinusoidal varying quantity. Only sinusoidal varying quantity can be treated as phasors. Now let us take the impedance and admittance. So resistance, if you have, so Z is equal to R, that is the impedance. So here you have a pure resistor. That is the reason we have Z is equal to R. The admittance is equal to the reciprocal of impedance. So admittance is the reciprocal of impedance. So here you have R, so here it will be 1 by R. When you have a pure inductor, then impedance is equal to J omega L and admittance is equal to 1 by J omega L. When you have a pure capacitor, the impedance will be 1 by J omega C and the admittance will be J omega C. So if the pure resistor, inductor and capacitors are there, we can represent that in the form of an impedance or 1 by Z, that is equal to admittance. Now the characteristic of the inductor and capacitor that we have already discussed. Inductor behave as short circuit for a DC quantity and open circuit for high frequency. What is the reason? XL, that is the inductive reactance, XL is equal to omega into L. This can be represented as 2 pi F, that is omega into L. Now, for the DC frequency, when we talk about the DC frequency, frequency is equal to 0 Hertz. This is DC, 0 Hertz. If frequency is 0, it means XL value is equal to 0. XL 0, it means it is a short circuit. You have seen that when we do the short circuit, if for a resistor, we simply short circuit this. So resistor is equal to 0. Here, the inductive reactance XL equal to 0. So that is a short circuit for DC. Now let us go for high frequency. What is happening at high frequency? Let us take the frequency to be infinite. If the frequency is infinite, the value of XL is basically infinite. XL is infinite. What is the meaning of that? That is basically an open circuit. So if the resistance is infinite, it means it is an open circuit. So XL is infinite, it means it is an open circuit. Same thing happened for a capacitor. Capacitor is open circuit at DC. What is the reason? XC is equal to 1 by 2 pi F into C. Now, if you put the frequency to be 0, you will get the XC value to be infinite. So it means it is an open circuit for DC. And short circuit at high frequency, because at high frequency, XC is equal to 1 by infinite, which is equal to 0. That is short circuit. So these property of inductor and capacitor, we should understand that in DC quantity and in AC quantity, what is happening to those. Now let us combine the resistance, inductance and capacitance. So we have resistor, inductor and capacitor, and for an AC network, we will have combination of these R, L and C. Remember, resistor, the angle between the voltage and current is not there, it is in phase. For an inductor, there is a 90 degree out of phase, for a capacitor also 90 degree. But here the current will lag the voltage, here the current will lead the voltage. So let us talk about the impedance now. Impedance Z is basically a complex quantity which is having a real value resistance and the imaginary value as X. Now I have not written whether X is inductive or capacitive. I have just written X. So R plus JX, this is a complex quantity having a magnitude Z and angle theta, where the magnitude of Z from the complex quantity can be represented as under root of real part square plus imaginary part square. So under root of R square plus X square. And the angle theta is basically 10 inverse of X by R. If you have a complex quantity where this is your Z, the real part, if you talk about the real part, this will be resistor. And if you talk about the imaginary part, this will be X, where the angle of Z will be equal to theta. So theta is equal to 10 inverse of X by R. The real part, that is the resistor, is Z cos theta, and the reactance or the imaginary part is Z sin theta. Here I have not written whether it is an inductor or a capacitor. It can be a combination of both. Admittance is the reciprocal of the impedance. So we know that Z is equal to voltage by current. It means the admittance is equal to current by voltage. So if you do the current by voltage, we have the admittance. If we have written the resistance is, impedance is equal to R plus JX, we can represent the admittance Y is equal to G plus JB. So this is the real part and this is the imaginary part. Real part is the conductance and the imaginary part is known as the susceptance. Okay, here the real part is the resistance and this one is reactance. This is, I'll tell here, reactance. So reciprocal of reactance is basically the susceptance. Now let us see, we have G plus JB, which is basically the admittance Y, which is the reciprocal of the impedance Z. So we have 1 by R plus JX. Let us do the rationalization of that. So G plus JB, we have 1 by R plus JX. We multiply that with the minus sign of the imaginary, then we have r minus jx by r square plus x square. Let us equate the real part and the imaginary part. So we will get the g value is equal to r by r square plus x square, and b value is minus, here we have a negative sign, x by r square plus x square. Now note here that the conductance g is not equal to 1 by resistance. This is the main mistake that a student commit whenever they are solving a problem. They directly take the conductance to be the reciprocal of the resistance. So whenever the impedance is given in this format, r plus jx, you want to obtain the g, so don't compute g is equal to 1 by r. Then it will be a great mistake here. G is not equal to 1 by r, rather g is equal to r by z. Okay, g is basically r by z square. Okay, because z is equal to under root of r square plus x square. The susceptance part, b is the susceptance, which is not directly the reciprocal of reactance, but it is minus of x by r square plus x square. So here you have to note this very carefully when you try to obtain the conductance and susceptance, and then you want to convert that into admittance. So this derivation is very important to understand how to convert the impedance and the admittance part. So here in this particular lecture, we focus much on the quantities, elements, resistor, inductor and capacitor. In the next lecture, we'll focus how to apply those in theorems. So whatever the theorems we have studied in the DC part, that is the Ohm's law, we have already covered Ohm's law today, KVL, KCL, Thevenin's, Norton's, everything in the AC quantity when inductor and capacitor will be there, we will cover from the next lecture onwards.